On in. My name is James Tarala. I'm going to be one of the presenters this morning. I'll give you just a quick background. I've had the opportunity to work with a lot of different organizations over the last few years, including here at RSA, and participate in these events. Most notably, I spend a lot of my time at the SANS Institute. Probably a lot of you have sort of met me there, so glad to see a lot of friendly faces in the crowd. And part of what we're going to be talking about this morning relates to what the Center for Internet Security is doing as well. And so that's one of the things you're going to find. We'll present on some of the work that we're doing there, including, as a lot of you have heard of, probably the Center for Internet Security's Critical Security Controls Project as well. We'll have some time to talk about that. I've had the privilege in the last 10 years of being one of the authors slash editors of that document, so I'm glad to have an opportunity to talk with you about some of those things this morning as well. But I want to start this morning, and I want to quote something. So I apologize, I'm going to read something off my phone, because frankly, this is a blog post that came out yesterday. So I want to read a post from Gene Spafford. If any of you sort of know Gene, or he's over at Purdue. Dr. Spafford's been around for a long time. Very, very bright individual. If you've not seen any of his work, I would definitely recommend it. But he's very honest about sort of what we're doing here in the cybersecurity space, including what we've all been doing here this week. And so he posted sort of a recap of his experience here at the conference this week. But there's a quote in there that sort of caught my attention, so I wanted to read it this morning to get us started this morning. And it said, and he's talking about the RSA conference this week, and he said, there seem to be more advertised product services around metrics. They don't agree with each other on what they should be measuring or how they should do it, but they claim to measure security. But here's the part that I think was kind of interesting from Gene's post. In many cases, this is a quote, I conjecture throwing dice would be cheaper and about as useful. And here's the thing, and I get that he's sort of being a little, you know, a little out there with that, and certainly a little antagonistic, but I bring that up only to say I don't want us to have that conversation this morning. I want to be able to have an honest conversation. I want to make sure that we have an opportunity to talk about metrics and measures and what those mean, to have sort of a good sort of academic conversation, but one that's practical and hopefully sends you home with some resources. The things that we're going to be talking about this morning, though, I want to let you know right away, these are all going to be available online. At the very end of the presentation, we do have a couple resources, a couple websites, where a lot of the things I'm going to be talking about this morning are already at and ready for you to download. So I don't want you to feel like you have to take a million notes. I also don't want you to feel like these things are vaporware. These are things that today you can use, the things that we're going to be getting into this morning. So I want to start by having a conversation about metrics, about measures, about KPIs, and sort of I want to give us today an architecture for what developing that sort of program looks like. And I can easily give you links. I can easily give you spreadsheets, and literally, we have spreadsheets of these metrics done for you. And like I said, we can have you download them and frankly walk away from the presentation right now. But the thing that I'm concerned about in every one of these talks that we give around KPIs, around metrics and measures, is that I feel like we jump ahead. And we've had a bunch of conversations with clients, even with people here at the conference this week, where people have been tasked with the responsibility of coming up with metrics and measures that they can use for their overall security programs, but frankly, they want to skip the foundations that make those programs effective. And what I want to talk about this morning is the whole idea of building that into a security program with the result being effective KPIs that we can use. So we'll give you those KPIs. I don't want you to leave without that. But at the same time, I want to make sure that we understand how to get to that point, because my fear is if we go home and initially try to jump to that step, frankly, a lot of us are going to fail. And that's the part that I want us to avoid. I want to see effectiveness. So what we're going to do is we want to start with more than just don't get breached. And I understand that obviously that's sort of a binary conversation, very important to a lot of us. And I'm not opposed to that being a measure, but I really have this fear that that's our number one metric, that at the end of the day, that's what we really are trying to figure out is how do I stay out of the newspaper? How do we stop that from happening? And like many of you, that's a fear. I have a client this week who's been on the phone with me pretty much every day because of a breach that happened this week alone. And it just, this stuff is happening. We can't get away from it. So the reality is I wanna make sure that we have a foundation. And that's what we're gonna be talking about hopefully over the next few minutes in this morning. So I wish I had like a week to talk to you about this slide alone. We don't, so let me go through it relatively quickly. The reality of the situation is if we're going to lay a foundation though, in information security and cybersecurity, we're creating security programs. And a program is not unique to cybersecurity. I have a fear that when we create these cybersecurity programs, that we think we're the first people to have ever done this. And we're not. Many of you have taken the time to get your PMP certifications or go through to try to better understand what it looks like to understand good project management, good program management principles. And the reality is when we look at these programs and how you run and build and sustain a program, there are well-known steps that we can follow. And if we look at some of those steps, we understand that one of the things we have to do is we have to understand, you know, what are the goals of that program? We have to understand for ourselves, do we have buy-in from that from stakeholders? We have to understand what that charter looks like. We have to go ahead and assign responsibilities and authorities to the program leadership to go ahead and achieve the goals of the program that we've established. That's what a charter is. That's what a charter does. And one of the very first things I would encourage us is if we've not taken the time to go to senior leadership and actually define that charter already, if you don't have that, take the time to do it. It's such a small step that gives such great results in the longer term if we can define for ourselves what are the goals we're actually trying to achieve. Not just don't get breached, right, but what are the goals you have? And I'm going to walk you through that here in just a second. But in addition to that, we want to make sure if we're building this program is we want to, first of all, of course, achieve those or establish those goals, what those goals are going to be. And then we also want to make sure that we empower stakeholders to go ahead and govern that program. That's part of the goal of that charter is to give the stakeholders who are involved in that program the ability to do that. We also want to make sure that we use that to clearly document our intentions. Now, here's, again, one of the pieces, kind of one of those critical pieces towards a measures or metrics program or KPI program that, frankly, most often fails. And if I look at sort of the two failure points I'm already seeing in this slide, is number one, we don't establish what our goals are. And specifically then, when it gets to cybersecurity, we don't actually define what it is that we're trying to do to achieve those goals. And what I'm going to call that is documenting your intentions. Now, I know a lot of us debate the term, right? You might say, okay, well, these are policies, these are procedures, these are standards, these are guidelines. I don't really care what you call them, but at some level, I believe it to actually establish this program, we've got to define what are the things, the good things, the controls that we're going to put into place in order to achieve our goals. But we've got to define that. So one of the things that I spend most of my life doing is security assessments. So I go organization to organization, and I ask them, all right, what are the good things you've decided that you should be doing? Like, what are you going to measure yourself against? And without fail, we miss these intentions being documented. It's 2019. You all know this is the right thing to do. I'm preaching to the, you know, to folks here who know these answers already. You guys know these are the right things to do, but the reality is we just don't do them still. And I fear that I'm the guy who's going to tell you to eat your vegetables. I think we know we need to document our intentions, but if you want to have a successful KPI program, you have to define what it is you want to measure. To define what it is you want to measure, you have to define what it is that you want to do. You have to have those controls documented, those intentions defined. So we're going to want to make sure that we have that. Whatever you call those, I don't really care. At that point, you can establish priorities within those controls, make sure you know what it is you want to do and when, have a plan for quality measurement, which I'm going to go ahead and show you here in a minute. At that point, then, we can go ahead and build in those measures. We can build in metrics. We can have those conversations. And that's the piece that I want to make sure that we talk about mostly today. Now, with that being said, first of all, I just want to be clear. There are no shortcuts to this process. And again, having this conversation with companies just, again, year after year, my fear is that we want to jump ahead. We say, okay, yeah, policies, yeah, write a charter. Okay, but James, fast forward, what are the metrics? Can you just give me the Excel spreadsheet already? Okay? And I will, right? I mean, don't get me wrong, we'll get to that point. But if you skip that step, you're bound to have failure. It's just inevitable at that point. And you see Mark Twain, and I love Mark Twain. If you see me present before, you know, I like to quote him a lot of times. But it's, even around our house, it's funny. Even my younger kids actually have started to use this phrase. But the idea is that, of course, if you eat a live frog first thing in the morning, nothing worse will happen to you the rest of the day. And so we always ask ourselves, right, what is today's frog? Right, what's the frog I'm supposed to eat today? And when it comes to these metrics or KPI programs, the frog that I'm going to ask you to eat is defining the controls that you want to implement. I know you don't want to do it. I know it's time consuming. I know getting consensus is hard. And we think about just sort of the time investment and going through and documenting. A lot of you would initially say to yourself, but James, but if I take the time to document policy, writing policy, that time could have better been used in, I don't know, deploying this really cool vendor that I found down on the vendor flow this week, right? And that would actually defend me. The policy doesn't defend me, but that cool widget that I got down at the vendor show, that defends me. Which is, I mean, there's some truth to that. But if you want to build a sustainable program, you've got to have everyone on board with what are the goals we're trying to achieve. Simple conversation. You decide that multi-factor authentication is something that might be of value. If any of you went to the SANS talk a couple days ago, you heard Heather Mihalik and a bunch of other people talk about different forms of authentication and good controls in that space. And one of the things that Heather said was, she said, listen, you know, MFA is going to be part of that solution going forward if we want to protect our presence online. And that's true. In fact, I'm a huge supporter of that MFA concept, that multi-factor authentication. If it's not on your radar already, I really hope that you start to consider that in the coming year. But that being said, if I believe the control that we want to have in place as MFA, if that's something that we want to have, then we need agreement in our teams that that's something we're going to do. If I try to jump ahead to the KPI and say, okay, my KPI is, you know, what percent of my applications are supporting and actively using, say, MFA, that's awesome as a metric, and I would encourage you to consider that. I think that's kind of a cool idea. But if you haven't decided that MFA is something you're willing to tolerate, well, then it's stupid to use that as one of your KPIs. It just doesn't make sense. Someone at a leadership level has to make a decision that, yes, this is the right thing to do. We know why we're going to do it. We know what risks it's specifically going to address. And as a result, we define our intention, which says we are going to go ahead and implement MFA on all of these application points. Then we can measure ourselves to say, are we doing the good thing that we believe we should be doing? But that's the piece, again, we've got to make sure we define first. That's the eating your vegetables component to this. So again, if we look at this then, let's start with that charter concept, because frankly, I know most of you haven't actually done this. Again, I know a lot of you know it's the right thing to do, but that doesn't mean you've actually done it. So the first thing that I would say is, if you've done nothing else, and frankly, if you do nothing else as a result of this presentation, I would encourage you to consider defining a program charter. Now, if you go to Project Management Institute, they're going to tell you there's a couple things in a charter you're going to want to define. One of those things are going to be your business goals. We'll talk about that here in just a second. The other thing you're going to want to define is there support from senior leadership for the program? Who's going to lead that program? Are resources going to be allocated to that program? Who are the stakeholders who are going to govern that program? Do we have a steering committee we're going to use, or whatever it is we have? But the piece I want to focus on is the piece around defining your business goals. And this is, again, something that I find organizations just aren't doing. Is that what are your goals for security? Not just don't get breached, but I mean, what are the goals you're hoping to achieve? So let me go back and tell you what I like to see in a charter. I like to, number one, define for ourselves, are there regulations that you're required to follow? Do you know what that looks like? Have you ever sat down and done an inventory to say, listen, these are the laws that I have to follow, I don't have a choice? Okay, define what those are. My guess is there's going to be controls in those requirements and those laws that you're going to have to follow. Now, I always know it's a choice, right, to follow law or not, but the reality is most of us will do that. And so let's say, for example, we have state of New York, just kind of going along with sort of the theme we just started here. So if we decide that we're going to do business in the state of New York, and let's say that we're going to work in the financial services industry in the state of New York, we know there's some new guidelines that came out a year or so ago, 18 months ago, for the state of New York and financial services, and we know that one of the things that's highly encouraged in that is the use of MFA. And so if we know we're going to go into the state of New York, if we know we're in that industry, then maybe that's something we want to consider. Or if you're in the state of Connecticut, for example, right now, and you're in healthcare, they actually have a very similar requirement. That if, again, you're in the state of Connecticut, you're maintaining access to PII or personally identifiable information, this healthcare specific, then we're going to want you to use MFA. Okay, but again, this is law, right? Okay, so number one in that charter, what are the laws that you have to follow? Number two, we're going to say, all right, are there standards that you believe you should follow? Are there things that you believe are right, things that you think sound good, standards of care, things like from NIST or other groups like that you believe might be the right thing to actually do? You're not required to by law, but as you're talking about leadership, about what your goals are for controls, you say, you know what, that looks right to me. We want to do that. Or we get audited a lot based on this standard, so let's use that as one of our goalposts. The last thing that I'll say then is the third thing you want to define in your charter is, are there contractual requirements that you have to follow, that you've agreed to follow, right? It doesn't mean that, again, this is something that all of you are going to have, but maybe you pick on one, for example, PCI. You don't have to follow PCI, right? it's one of those things where, again, if you decide to work even with, you know, the payment card standards and such, you can say, listen, we don't need to process credit cards, so we don't have to do this. It's not a law, right? But it's a choice. It's a contract we've gotten into. We've said we want to process cards, and so as a result, we'll follow those data security standards, right? The DSS side of it. So as a result of that, there are things in there that maybe you decide to do. Again, we use MFA as our example again, right? If you decide you're going to follow by contract PCI, well, then we know administrator access needs to use MFA as a result of the new 3.2 standard that PCI has put out. But again, at the end of the day, what you're doing is you're establishing the context of what those intentions are going to be. Because now what we can do is when senior leadership says, okay, these are the things that we believe we're supposed to be doing, right? Again, from a legal standpoint, from a contractual standpoint, from just a standard standpoint, then the time comes we can actually say, okay, as a result of agreeing to those things, well, then here's the broader set of intentions that now we know we need to do, right? That helps us define that for us. Again, we're going to do that simply because this lays the foundations for the measures, the KPIs that we're going to be actually doing later. Now, there's all kinds of standards you can choose from. And there's a buffet, right? And I think a lot of us are very well aware of this, right? It's getting worse and worse. In fact, I would argue in the coming years, if I pull out my crystal ball, what I sort of would imagine is, especially at the state level, we're going to see a lot more of this coming out. That I expect that we're going to find a lot of regulation, especially, that we're not expecting to see. The state of North Dakota, for example, up until just recently, for example, many of you may not know, defined PII very broadly. They said any unique identifier that's related to customer information is considered PII. So imagine you have a database and you have a table in that database which has a unique record ID, which is just a unique record ID just for that table, just because that's what you put in your table. Well, it turns out even if that record ID has no value outside of the context of that table, that data, that number, is still considered PII. And so if that data is lost, you're responsible by North Dakota law to go ahead and do breach notification, right? And there's crazy things like that that's out there. I think the states are going to continue to have those. Now, thankfully, North Dakota backed off on that. There's some lobbying that went on by some cybersecurity folks to kind of back that off a little bit. But those are the kind of things that we're going to have to be aware of at the state level. Also, one of the folks that I work with very closely over at Center for Net Security is a gentleman by the name of Tony Sager. And Tony likes to say quite a bit in a lot of his presentations that when it comes to standards like this, what you're going to find is standards, for the most part, are copied and pasted from other existing standards. And a lot of you have noticed this already, right? And so what you're going to find is going forward, there's a lot of sort of momentum around the creation of new standards. People like making new standards. I mean, how many new ones have we seen coming out in the last few years? So expect that this is only going to grow. But again, if we understand what our goals are, what we're going to go after, then we can simply map our intentions against whatever the new laws and the crazy stuff that comes out down the road. But as long as we know what that is, that's where we want to start. Now, obviously, those of you who know me know that I'm a little bit biased in this conversation. One of the documents, if you've not looked at this already, that I would highly encourage you to check out is going to be what's going on over at the Center for Net Security and those CIS controls. We created those critical security controls specifically to give you a set of technical controls that are pre-prioritized, ready to go, so you can use that as a foundation of your defense. In fact, if I go back a couple slides here, just to kind of get you aware, if I'm looking here at where those CIS controls fit, this is counting as an industry standard, at least for right now. It's never been our intention that this would be law. Now, I understand that Kamala Harris, when she was Attorney General out here in California, did come out, though, and say that, listen, hey, if you have a breach in the state of California and you know you want to let us know about that, make sure you let us know relatively quickly, and we're going to want to ask you, hey, listen, are you following a standard of care? You know, a standard of care like the CIS controls, right? So I understand that there's those kind of conversations that are going on, but I don't look at us as sort of regulatory right now. I see us really more as optional, sort of that industry standard area more than anything else. But if nothing else, what we're going to see is it really is hopefully going to be more in that area of what we see as cyber hygiene. And what we're trying to do is help organizations understand, what does a standard of care look like? What does hygiene look like? And for those of you who aren't aware, we do put out a new version of this about every year. And it's about that time of year. We're about looking at this right now as well. You can see those 20 families of controls. If you've not seen these before, again, just a quick reference point for you there. But just to let you know, we do have a new version that's coming out soon. Now, normally we do tie it to the RSA conference so we can have good conversations about it. This year we decided to put it off a couple months. In fact, I was talking with Kurt Dukes, who's helped leading the program just a couple minutes ago in the speaker room, and it looks like we're gonna probably shoot for about an April release. We do have a 7.1 version that's come out. You're gonna see, for those of you who haven't seen or you've been exposed maybe to previous versions, we do have some new things around not just clarifications of the wording. The spirit of the controls is almost 100% identical. For those of you who've seen the older versions, 7 and 7.1 are almost the same. But one of the big things, because of some of the comments in the state of California and other feedback from the community, is we're trying to show you implementation classes or levels. In other words, you're a small business, what should you be focusing on? You're a large-scale enterprise, what should you be focusing on? And we're trying to do a little more clarification. And one of our big goals in this program is to help organizations try to understand a little bit better what are the things that you should be doing, so that it's not this mystery, so it's not you having to figure it out on your own, that we can rely on the industry as a whole to be able to give you some of those, that prioritization and feedback. In the version 7 release that we put out about a year ago this time, we had over 1,000 organizations providing us feedback. Not like downloading the guide. We have like hundreds of thousands of downloads of the guide itself. But we had over 1,000 organizations just giving us feedback on things that we should be updating. It was amazing. I felt bad for some of the folks who were doing data entry for us, but it was, they really did give us some cool feedback on ways we can improve the process. One of the big things, though, sort of leading this into the conversation about KPIs that I want you to know, though, is with the controls, one of the things that we tried to do for you was rewrite the controls in version 7 so that every time we asked you to do something, every control statement was one ask per statement. The reason why we did that was we wanted to prepare it for the purpose of measures. Because again, if you have a control statement, which is a paragraph, and that paragraph has 10 things it asks you to do, well, you've got to come up with 10 measures to measure the 10 things in that statement. So we wanted to be very clear and say, listen, every time we have a statement of something we want you to do, we want to make sure we only ask you for one thing, so it's easy to measure that one thing in the longer term. So that was one of the big things we rewrote with version 7 and 7.1. So that's one of the things we put out there. And as a result, we were able to not only release that, but we do have a measures guide as well, and those KPIs ready for you to download. So the theory behind the KPIs and the theory behind this process goes back to what we said a little bit ago. Now, you can go home and you can do all this yourself, and I have no problems with that. I'm a huge fan of threat modeling. I'm a huge fan of you guys doing control selection yourselves. But I also know a lot of you are busy. And again, if it comes time to you deciding, right, do I want to write a policy library? Do I want to write a series of KPIs? Or do I want to go ahead and just implement this shiny widget? A lot of you want to do the widget. And it's not a bad idea to do a widget. But I want to be able to give you these resources so you have them as an option. And the thought process was this. So the thought is, if the process for dealing with maturity and defining the KPIs starts with a control process, then we have to define those first. So if you've not eaten your vegetables, again, let me just be clear. The first thing that I need you to do is define what are those things you believe are right. And if you haven't done that yet, you have to start there. Go home, talk to your leadership, define a charter, and define what are the controls that you believe are right. That's step one. When that's done, then you can define how to measure or quantify, are you doing those things that you believe are right? Now, I want to clarify one of the differences we have between a metric and a measure. And we've actually documented this in a white paper over at the Center for Internet Security. The difference that we have between those two terms is this. I'm gonna say, my name is James Tarala, and I am 6'2". That's a height, that's a measure. You can take a ruler, you can stand it next to me, right? That's how tall I am, right? But that's just a measure. It's not any sort of judgment call on how tall I am. It's just something we can quantify. Now, on the other hand, if we say James is tall, James is short, James is average height, that's more of a judgment call on the quantification that I just did. That's what we are going to call a metric. The measure is what you can quantify. If we go ahead and do the metric, that's now the judgment call on that statement. So I go back to MFA. I say, all right, I've decided my control is that we're going to do multi-factor authentication. So we decide we're going to do that. And therefore, I look at all of my application interfaces, and I realize that 60% of all of my applications are currently utilizing MFA. Much higher than probably reality for a lot of you. Probably a lot of you are like 5%, right? Or tops, let's say. But let's say that it's like 60% or whatever the number happens to be. So we decide that that's our number. All right, well then a metric is, all right, is that good? Is that bad? Are we making progress? Is there still risk? Right, that's the metric. And by aggregating these metrics together, we can come up with a model for maturity. And that's what our hope is in the longer term, that we can use that more for that maturity scoring. So the place I would have you start is start simply. You can't run before you walk here. You've got to start slow. We've got to decide what we're capable of measuring. Now, if I come to you and say, okay, we need to know what percent of our applications are utilizing MFA, and you say, but James, I haven't actually decided to do MFA yet. Like, I don't know that I can even have that conversation, or I'm not sure we actually even have a tool in place for that. Well, here's the thing. Before we start trying to get into these crazy percentages and actually looking at our systems, how about you just ask yourself, am I doing that, yes or no? And so one of the ways that we go ahead and encourage starting this is we have a spreadsheet out over at auditscripts.com that ties to the controls, and we basically do this. We say, okay, are you doing the good thing, yes or no? To what degree are you doing the good thing? Okay, MFA, if that's something that's useful, well, it turns out in the CIS controls, we've defined that MFA is useful in control 4, in control 11, in control 12, and in control 16. So if you're measuring yourself against those control families, all four of those are going to ask you to do MFA. So again, let me just ask you, are you doing it, yes or no? What's the point of me trying to go out and grab a WMI call, let's say, to query your applications and find out do they support it or not, if you haven't even made the decision that you want to do this yet? So the very first step that we're going to say is if you want to get just a really simple measure where you're at, do an attestation. Okay, simply ask yourself the question, are you doing it, yes or no? And is it going to be perfect? No, of course not. But the thing that I love, Alan Poller, the guy who founded the SANS Institute, always tells me, he says, listen, don't let perfect be the enemy of good enough. Right? Sometimes we just ask ourselves the question, are we doing that good thing, yes or no? And then once we've decided to, we get down the road later for maturity, then maybe we can automate gathering information or intelligence around what percent of our systems are actually doing that thing. But let's start small. And again, there's no reason to do a deep dive if the basics aren't actually done. So I'd encourage you, again, this is on the website, it's a free download, just go grab it. And what it does is simply just a checklist, just a spreadsheet, it gives you nice little scores there and a dashboard you can use to go ahead and score yourself on that. Now, starting in version 7 of the controls, one of the things that we wanted to do, though, was go beyond just simple attestations. And I mentioned already that we did sort of that one ask statement, right, that one ask idea. So what we did was we added in the capability as well to do a quality management program. So what we wanted to make sure that we did was we had plenty of opportunity to talk about what does quality look like. And in previous versions of controls, like 6.1 and earlier, we had had these measures and thresholds guides, or we had kind of defined metrics. But to be honest, it was us and our opinions. It was us and our interpretations and people kind of looking at things. And we thought, well, wouldn't it be great if we could tie into an existing quality management program? And we said, okay, well, what quality management programs are out there? And so we started looking around, and honestly, the one that kept popping up over and over again was what Jack Welch did over at GE, and of course, Motorola actually started. And we said, why not look at Six Sigma? Even if it's something you don't love, like I can feel some of your eyes rolling, like as I mentioned the word, like I can just sort of feel it up here, and that's fine, right? But the reality is your leadership understands these words. If I say, listen, we are Sigma level 2, that has meaning to someone who's got that quality management background. So your leadership already speaks these terms. So why not co-opt their language for our purposes? So we said, all right, so what if then we go ahead and use their quality management programs to manage our program as well? What I said earlier, right? The idea behind this is that we're not reinventing the wheel. Let's just use what the industry has already come up with. So the way that we handled this is we said, okay, so first of all, again, we have to go back to the beginning, which is we have to know what it is we're measuring. So what's the control that we believe is right? Okay, what's the good thing that we believe we're supposed to be doing? So let's say in this example we give here, in the first critical security control we have is CSE number 1. That's basically the idea that you need to know what's in your environment. And if we don't know what's in our environment, we can't defend what we don't know is there, right? So the very first control we have has to do with inventory, very similar to what the cybersecurity framework has done as well, right? Control 1 is all about inventory. So let's say that we agree that only authorized devices should be in our environment, things that we know about. So that's number 1. So we want to maintain a detailed asset inventory so we know what we're trying to defend. So number 1 statement, the intention statement we give is that we believe that we should have an inventory and that all the devices we're trying to defend are in that inventory. Okay, we won't debate the point, but let's just say that's something we've decided is a good thing to do. It turns out lots of these standards will ask for this. All right, then what we're going to do is we're going to ask ourselves a question. Now that question and what you see in that second box or the middle box there, that's part of what we're going to call our measures guide. So remember that Excel spreadsheet I told you you could download? We're going to have basically a list of these questions pre-populated for you, ready to go, but this is the one that just happens to tie to this inventory statement. So the question we ask is, all right, what percent of your devices are not, okay, and we have to do some nots, unfortunately, just to make the percents work right, but are not presently in that asset inventory. And now let's say that we have the opportunity to go beyond attestation. So I could easily ask an attestation question and say, okay, do you have an asset inventory? Or the question I like to ask companies is, what's your record of truth? Do you have a record of truth for logical computing assets? Do you have ServiceNow? Do you have Archer? Are you using Rapid7 for this? I don't really care. But do you have a tool that says, if James, if you were to ask me what my record of truth is, it's this database. Okay, now I'm gonna ask you that question. Let's be honest, right? A good 90% of you, and I'm making those numbers up, but a good 90% of you are gonna say, yeah, we don't really have a record of truth. Is that fair? Yeah. You've got the ability to do inventories, right? You can run SCCM, you can run Rapid7, you can run Nessus, you can generate a list of assets, but that's not necessarily the same as a record of truth. Okay, sidebar, right? We can come back to that conversation another day. But the point is, let's say that we decide we want that inventory as part of this conversation. Well, then what we can do is, if we've gone beyond attestation, we know we have that system, then what can we do? Let's say we run two scans. Let's say we're using, I don't know, ServiceNow Asset Discovery. So we use ServiceNow Asset Discovery, we come up with, let's say, 10,000 nodes in our environment. But let's say that we do a scan, and there's, I don't know, let's say 11,000 nodes with Nmap. Okay, so we have one tool that tells us one number that has sort of this asset list in it, and we want another tool, Nmap or whatever it is you want to use, and that gives you a different number. And let's just say that whatever the difference between the two of those is 10%. Let's say you have 10% off. Now, here's the thing that I always hear from executives, though. And so a lot of my time, I already said, was spent doing assessments. And in every assessment I do, the follow-up to that assessment is I want to talk to a board of directors. And that's what we do. And so when I talk to boards of directors, what they want to know is, all right, well, where are we at? Like, where's the quality? What do we need to do next? Where's our risk at? They ask these kinds of questions. And they always say to me the same thing. They say, James, listen, I don't want to be Fort Knox. Have you had this conversation? Right? I don't want to be the NSA, right? I don't want to be whoever their view is of like perfect security, right? They don't want to be that person. They want to be good enough. And in fact, inevitably, it's kind of a pet peeve of mine, but inevitably somebody on the board says, and James, you know, it's like the bear in the woods. I don't have to be faster than, you know, than everybody, than the bear. I just have to be faster than you, right? And inevitably, like, this comes up in a board meeting. I roll my eyes every time I hear it. But the point is, I was at Pinehurst presenting to a board out there, and they had played 18 holes of golf in the morning. They came in at lunch, ate lunch, listened to my cybersecurity presentation at lunch in the hotel there at Pinehurst, and they went and played 18 in the afternoon, right? And there's this older guy on the board, probably in his early 70s, and he gives his bear in the woods story. And so my response to him is, I said, listen, that's fine and all, but there's more than one bear in the woods, right? That story doesn't really work anymore, and I don't know if we want to use that. And so what we do is we say, okay, so let's say that our goal isn't whatever we see perfection is, and so we just want to come up with something that we believe is right. What if we said to ourselves, listen, we don't have to be perfect, we just want to be good enough. And again, the example I give a lot of times is the Food and Drug Administration, right? Food and Drug Administration knows in your lunch today that your lunch is not going to be perfect, right? Let's all be honest with ourselves. Do any of you want to eat rat hair for lunch today? Right? No, and some of you know where this is going, right? But the FDA has said, right, by law and regulation, that a food manufacturer is allowed to have a certain amount of rat hair in your food. That's acceptable. Like, it's not perfection. We're not trying to be perfect. We'd love to have no rat hair. No rat hair is a wonderful thing, right? But the reality is you're going to eat a little rat hair at lunch today. That's just kind of how things go. And so at the end of the day, we just have to decide, like, what's acceptable. Like, how much rat hair do we want to have for lunch today, right? Right before lunch, too. Like, it's a perfect time. It could have been worse. This could have been after lunch, right? It could have been much worse. Okay. So, but the idea is that they give that idea of quality is that we don't have to shoot for perfection. We have to decide what's an acceptable level. And so the idea is, let's go back to our 10% number. So let's say that 10% of our assets aren't in that database. Well, then what we can do is we can look at these Six Sigma numbers and say, okay, if Sigma level one is 69% or less of our assets meet this standard, if my number is 10%, have we achieved Sigma level one? Yes, right? Because 69% or less, our number is 10%, we've achieved Sigma level one. Okay, level two, 31% or less. Same thing, right? We're 10%, that's under 31%, so we've achieved Sigma level two. Sigma level three, 6.7%. No. Okay, so if we knew that 10% of our assets weren't in that database, then what that tells me is then that we've achieved Sigma level two. Now, what you do is when we go to our leadership teams then is we say, listen, leadership team, what level do you want to be? And you decide, you tell us what does quality look like, and we'll help you achieve it. We're not going to tell you what you have to do. We're not going to tell you what percent of your systems have to do MFA. We're going to tell you anytime you don't use MFA that you're going to go ahead and accept risk. But how much risk do you want to accept? MFA is the answer. We know MFA is the answer. We know it works, all right? But what percent of the time are we willing to ignore that? And that's the kind of conversation we can have. And if you've decided as an organization that we want to be Sigma level three, which is a pretty decent standard, and again, even if I say Sigma level three, that's still 6.7% of my population isn't doing the thing that I believe is right. Okay, we're not even talking level four or higher. This isn't perfection by any means, right? This is far from perfection. Like, can an attacker utilize 6.7% of failure? Heck yeah, right? There's all kinds of good stuff they can do in that. But we have to make small decisions. Where do we want to start? And if we believe Sigma level three is an appropriate place to start, then let's achieve that first, and then we can move closer to four. Then we can decide, is four acceptable? And my guess is, for those of you in the room today, you're nowhere near three. Like, three is like 5 years from now possibility, looking at models like this. I mean, that's just the reality. We had a utility in the Northwest, and they had said they wanted to do the CIS controls and use this logic. And so they said, listen, we're going to do this, and we're going to do it by the end of the calendar year. And that was last year. And the senior executive who said that actually said, listen, and we are so convinced that we're going to do this that I will stake my bonus on it. He stressed out his employees, and he didn't get his bonus, right? But the reality was that they knew where we needed to go. They're just completely unrealistic on timelines. We generally tell people this is at a minimum a 3 to 5 year process. At a minimum, from where you are right now, okay? Those of you at the RSA conference, from where you are, this is a 3 to 5 year process. Okay, this is not something you're gonna achieve overnight. All right, so that being said, this is then, I know you can't read this and I don't expect you to, but the point of this is to say that we have not only that one measure for you though, but we have that same set of measures for all 171 subcontrols that are in those CIS controls. So we've defined those for you, we've defined the percents for you, we've asked the questions in such a way that the percentages are the right direction. It's kind of like, you know, golf versus basketball. You can't have a high score be good and a high score be bad, you know, depending on the game you're playing, right? You've got to make sure that everything goes in the same direction. So we wanted to make sure that was all written out for you. So again, this spreadsheet with all this already predefined for you is up on the CIS website. Now, you don't have to follow these controls. You don't have to follow these measures. But if you're looking for guidance, you're looking for some ideas, inspiration, or frankly, you just want to copy and paste, right? This is all out there for you. We try to give this to you to make it easy so you don't have to do this work yourself. That's what the committees of folks are out there doing. The other thing that we've tried to do then is we've tried to take each of those subcontrols, and this is where, in my opinion, it actually gets really cool. Now, please just understand what we're about to talk about. This is way down the road for most of you. But let me just give you a vision for this, because this is where, to me, this gets really cool. So imagine now that we know the good things we want to do, the controls. We know the measures that we want to do to go ahead and understand what level of maturity we are. We've also defined in the same guidance, though, what technology platforms you need to have in order to do those measures. We've also given what we call entity relationship diagrams, like you see on the screen behind me there, which actually go through and show you these are those objects you need to have to achieve those goals. So we don't give you like the name of the vendor itself, but if I look at this and I say, okay, asset inventory database, to me that's going to be ServiceNow, or to me that's going to be Archer or whatever, well then you just go ahead and download this guide, which we have again up on the website, just download it, then you can write the name of the vendor next to the object that's there. So all of those objects are pre-populated for you. And again, it's in the measures guide, so you can see how that maps out. And again, that's kind of cool, but it's not really cool. What's really cool then is we can use that for the purpose of automation. Because now what we can start to do is take data feeds from each of those systems so that it's not a manual effort to figure out, well, are we 10% or are we 12%? What if you could automate that process? And what if we could pull that into these dashboard systems, again, your Archers of the world, your GRCs of the world, whatever it is that you're going to use, and we could then present it that way. And in fact, here's the thing that I think would be exciting about this whole thing, is once we get to that point, we already know what cyber hygiene looks like, right? We have a standard of care, right? Kamala Harris said that this is what she believes it is, or we can define that for ourselves. And then we have that standard of care. Information security then becomes a business intelligence problem. If we know what good looks like, if we know how to measure good, it's just about taking automated feeds from the sensors or the instrumentation that we have already defined and understanding where is their risk. This becomes simply an issue of data analytics or business intelligence. And that's what I think is exciting. I know we're not there, most of us today, but I can tell you, if you talk to some of these vendors, this capability exists in a lot of the vendors out there, the GRCs of the world, the Kennas of the world, and those kind of companies. This is pre-done for you. Granted, some of it's a little more expensive, right, than others, but it is out there. In fact, I'll even argue that there's some pretty interesting open source projects. If you've seen things like Aramba or some of these tools, it's a German company, for example, that does ERP. A lot of these capabilities are in open source platforms as well. So again, I have a couple minutes left. I'll take just a couple questions. But the thing that I want to emphasize is this. You can't start on KPIs until you've defined what good looks like. Okay, that's where I want you to start. Once you've defined what good looks like, we can define how we're going to measure good. And once we've done that, we can look at the automation, look at some of the instrumentation around that. So again, give you some things here to think about going forward. We do have some resources over at the Center for Internet Security, over at auditscripts.com to go ahead and give you, again, some of those free things that I mentioned earlier. Please take advantage of that. And again, I'll also mention, if you want to reach out to me, you've got my contact info. I'm always happy to answer some questions for you after the conference as well. Now, I've got a few minutes left. Again, please take advantage of my email. Again, that's what I'm here for. I'm always happy to answer questions. This is what I do. But I've got a couple questions coming up. Let me go ahead and take those, and we'll use every minute that we've got. Yes, sir?
Not so much a question, but an observation.
Yeah.
CIS, CSC metrics only measure completeness.
Yes.
If you take a look at this, or you take a look at ISO, you'll see that you'll also want to measure effectiveness, and you'll want to measure impact.
Sure.
So as you mature your programs and leverage the CIS resources, which, by the way, are excellent, and we are using them ourselves,
awesome.
You're going to want to take a look at, for those controls where the questions of relevance or impact are appropriate, such as an example, spam filtering.
Sure.
As just one out of a hat, where you're going to want to figure out what is effective.
Right.
And what is impact, both good impact to the organization as well as adverse impact to the organization.
Right.
And develop ways to measure that, because that, at the moment, does not come from CISC.
Right. And well, let me give you an example of that, so everybody understands where it's coming from, because he's absolutely right. So let's make a really, really easy one. So you say for yourself, we're going to do vulnerability management. So we're going to try to understand, okay, are you doing vulnerability management consistently across your systems? But then the follow-up to that is, okay, what are the CVSS ratings, for example, right, that my vulnerability scanner is telling me that I need to fix? And it's awesome if I know that 100% of my systems are being scanned via Nessus or something like that, but if they're scanning via Nessus and my CVSS ratings are crazy, well, then that doesn't actually defend me, right? Yeah, so the follow-up to this conversation, and that's kind of next, right? If we had another hour, that's where we would go, and that's exactly right. You want to look at not just that completeness and is the control there, but once we know the control is in place, what is that instrumentation telling you, right? Like CVSS ratings would be a great example of something like that. So yeah, absolutely, 100% right. Yes, sir?
Great, thank you very much for the informative presentation. So if I took your advice and approached my board, my executive board, on Six Sigma, where we should be, or have them tell me where we should be from a risk management perspective,
yeah,
I'll probably get the glazed over look.
What sure.
percentage of my hardware assets are not in the inventory? They're not going to be able to figure, well, you should have 100% well.
Sure.
Typically, there's a cost associated with that, obviously.
Yeah.
What would be your advice to talk to the board about?
Great question. Okay, so what I would do is, if you were to say, okay, James, I need at least a bare minimum, give me like a recipe, give me bare minimum, I need to talk to the board, I need to get sort of a good plan for this. What I would tell you is this: don't try to eat the elephant in one bite, you're not going to. I would say start small, be effective with what you have. If you could say, well, what is sort of the bare minimum cyber hygiene? I would say this: look at the CIS controls 1 through 6. All right, there's 6 families. Each of them has like 5 to 10 statements. That's what we consider cyber hygiene. If you do the rest of them, it's great, it's gravy, but that's the core that I'd have you start with. And as far as looking at sort of standards of care, I think there's a lot of really neat places we can go to. We can go to places like National Governors Association. We can look at State of California, et cetera, and actually say, listen, a lot of people have defined this as a standard of care. Now, that being said, we can't necessarily get level, you know, 5 overnight. What I would probably tell you to shoot for is do controls 1 through 6 at level 3 of Six Sigma. And if you can do that, I promise you're going to feel better about where you're at. Now, if you can go further, awesome. But what I think what you want to do is you want to give them that target and say, listen, what we're not going to do is we're not going to pick something randomly out of a hat. But board of directors, listen, we've heard you. We know you want specific KPIs. We have gone to the industry. We've looked for cyber hygiene and standard of care. This is what it is. And so we're going to shoot for level 3 to start. And then we're going to report back to you, let you know how we're doing. Now, the downside of that is now you have accountability too. So make sure you follow up on that. Make sure you do the things that are there. But that would be sort of my bare minimum standard of care there. All right. For the sake of time, I know we only have a little bit left. I'll give you maybe one more question before we let you go. All right. Sounds great. Thanks for making it here on a Friday. Glad you could be here. Enjoy the rest of your conference.